join me. Father God, we bless you, we praise you. We thank you for all the love that's going on right now. We thank you for all the people that are here. God, I pray that you would help us to praise you this morning. You are worthy of our time. Obviously, we're here, so I pray that you would just bring us close to you this morning, Jesus. I ask these things in Jesus' name.
Dinosaurs roamed the earth and hippies were in this country. There was a band that had a song that they came out with, probably the most famous song they ever did, that was the same title as the band. And the song was called Who Are You by The Who. Have you ever heard this song? Yeah, it's in it, now it's running through your head, isn't it? Who are you? All right. Great. I'm glad you sang along with me on that one. You want them to help you, and like two people were helping me, and they were youth workers. Everybody else was like, oh, really? Go ahead and make a fool of yourself, preacher. You'll entertain us. So my question for you this morning, it might seem strange, is who are you? When someone asks you that question, if anyone indeed does ask you that question, how do you answer? Who are you? Well, you might give your name, right? You say, I am such and such. Or you might respond with a relationship. Rachel's email address is mrscraigwilson@yahoo.com. Okay, now you can all email her. All right. So that might be your response. You respond who you are according to a relationship. Or you might respond with your career choice or what you would consider to be your calling. Okay, I am an engineer. I am a salesman. I am an attorney. I am a preacher. There's all sorts of ways. You might respond with where you're from. I am a Texan. I am an Arizonan. I am an American, and so forth. However, all of these responses really fall short of answering that question at its deepest level. Who are you really? Well, first of all, let's look at who you're not. You are not your parents. And we kind of start figuring that out about the time we're teenagers, right? This is why, by the way, youth ministry is so important, because teenagers need the opportunity to have a healthy, positive environment where they can go and seek out their own identity outside of their family. They're doing it anyway, but they're usually looking for identity in other places. But when you provide them with a good, healthy youth ministry, then they have an opportunity to seek identity in a place that's teaching the Word of God. That's the value of a good youth ministry. But we all have established an identity other than our parents. The issue is many times we live in the shadow of the past, and whatever, maybe many good things happened to you when you were a child. Maybe some bad things happened. Maybe many bad things happened to you. But you are not your parents. You are not the same as your parents. And you are also not your past. You may have had a glorious past. Maybe you were a high school athlete. Maybe you were the star quarterback. Maybe you were the cheerleader. Maybe you were somebody who had a very high GPA, and you went to college and you were well respected. And Many people sort of live in the past, in the glory days of the past. Other people live in the shadow of the negativity of their past and the bad things that happened to them in the past. There may have been abuse that happened in your past or neglect that happened in your past. Or maybe when you go back, there's actually a movie that's sort of predicated on this that I keep seeing previews for where some guy who was, I guess, unpopular in his high school comes and gets into the life of another fellow and his wife and starts tormenting them in the present. And the movie preview starts by saying, so-and-so killed this person who, they thought stole their girlfriend in high school or whatever. Well, some people kind of live in the past like that, don't they? It's like, I know for some of us, high school is not that far in the past. For some of us, it's a long way in the past. But it's a significant time, middle school, high school, and things happen to us. And sometimes we can live in the shadow of those things, and we can allow that to overshadow our identity. Maybe you weren't so popular when you were in middle school or high school, and to this day, you have this image of yourself as somebody that is just not well-liked or is not popular. But I've got news for you. You are not your past. Amen? Well, I could go on and on with that. You're not your parents. You're not your past. Well, what are you? Well, I guess that's a good place to start then, isn't it? We need first to define what we are. Now, I don't mean just what I am, but I mean what we are as human beings. You need to really start there because there's a good deal of confusion today about this. Now, it is almost impossible to have any source that brings you into the world of the media and not have become aware that Cecil the Lion was killed by a big game hunter, right? And there's all of this outcry about this, and maybe that made you sad as well. And, you know, we look at animals sometimes, and we think of animals as being so significant and so important. But I want to say something to you. You, as a human being, have a life that is unique and sacred. It is unique and sacred because unlike the animals who are God's creation and who God loves, you have been made in God's image. You are the only part of the only species that Scripture teaches are made in God's image. The Scripture at the very, very beginning says, in the beginning, God made human beings, made man in his own image, male and female, he created them. He created you as a human being in his image. That's what you are. You are a being that is unique and that is sacred and is created in God's image. That's why you hear some of us having such an outcry at this issue with Planned Parenthood selling the body parts of aborted fetuses. Now, we can think of this as horrendous if we are in opposition to abortion. But all you need to do is recognize that human beings are unique. And I posted something recently, and I kind of maybe jumped on the bandwagon of this, but somebody put a little meme, a picture up there with some text in front of it that said, if they were selling lion body parts, the media would be all over it. That's absolutely true. Don't you think that would be true? If somebody had taken, because big game hunters take the head, usually, of the animal that they've killed. Now, you may think that this is appalling, and I understand your position, but big game hunting goes back a long, long way. Am I in favor of them killing Cecil? No. But the fact that I know his name like he's a person, I think is ridiculous. Most Zimbabweans don't even know what this lion is or who this lion is. We've made this into a big deal. It's a first world problem. It's not their problem. Did you know? More importantly, did you care? The unemployment rate in Zimbabwe is 80%. Do you care about that? You're worried about a lion that represents Zimbabwe, but do you care that most Zimbabweans don't even know who this lion is? That for most Zimbabweans, when you kill an animal like that, it is either for food or it is to keep it from killing your animals? We need to have the right perspective. Certainly, we should be concerned about our pets. Certainly, we should be concerned about animals. And certainly, you can argue for or against big game hunting. I'm not for big game hunting. In all honesty, my personal perspective is if you're not going to eat it, you don't have to kill it. in order to keep yourself safe or your family safe, then you really don't need to be hunting it. Right? That's my perspective. Trophy hunting, I think, is just ridiculous, all right? But it's an old pastime. So, you know, Mia Farrow putting this dentist's address on Twitter so that nutbags can go and attack the guy and try to kill the guy, I think that's ridiculous. It's utterly ridiculous. If you want to argue against the guy and what he did, I think that's perfectly fine. That's acceptable. Sit down and have an argument with him. But to treat that animal as though that was a person and to treat him as though he was a murderer is ridiculous because animals are not people.
That's right.
People are uniquely created in God's image, and you are the only being in the universe, or you're a representative of the human race, the only beings in the... Do you know Scripture doesn't even say that angels are made in God's image? Do you realize that? You occupy a unique place in God's creation. Wow. Just think about that for a minute. It elevates you. Now, you have an animal body. I mean, we can do studies on rats and so forth, and it can tell us a good bit about how the body operates because there's a fundamental body plan that is changed in different species, but it's a fundamental basic body plan that you can look at. It's kind of like an automobile. If you know how an internal combustion engine works, you can work on a motorcycle or you can work on a Mercedes. Because although they're very different than one another, they're still operating on the same fundamental plan. The same thing happens when it concerns animals and looking at how our bodies are. But you're not an animal. You're something more. Amen?
Amen.
You need to start with that because it elevates you and it lets you know, wow, I am special. So think about how much you love your pet. And then consider that is God's creation, but you are made in His image.
Yeah.
That elevates you that much higher, and that lets you recognize, well, then I must be significant in some way. Okay? So you need to start off by understanding what you are. Now, once you understand that you are a being uniquely created in God's image, you need to start defining, well, then who am I as separate from all of the other 7.5 billion human beings on earth and however many more came before that? Who am I uniquely? Because just like your fingerprint is unique, you are unique. And you have been put here for a purpose. Now, you may think, you may have parents who were good to you and they told you you were special and they told you you were smart. Or you may have had parents that didn't do that. They either said nothing, or they derided you, they discounted you, they didn't make you feel as though you were special or unique or important. But the reality is God created you for a reason. You're here for a reason. And even if you were quote-unquote an accident from the perspective of your parents, you are no accident. God doesn't make accidents. God created you uniquely in His image, and you are not an accident. Say, I am not an accident. Say, I am here for a reason. You are here for a reason, okay? The first and fundamental reason you are here is to make up your mind as to whether you will believe in this God that created you and choose to live with Him forever, because you don't have to do that. Now, the option is not positive. Hell is not a great place to want to spend however much of the rest of eternity you're going to have to spend in hell, right? That's not a great alternative, but it is still your option. Whether you choose to submit and surrender to God and live with Him forever in eternity, or whether you choose to reject God, disbelieve in Him, and go your own way, that is your choice, and that's the first choice that you need to make. But once you've made that choice, hey, I want to give my life to God, then you need to realize that God identified Himself in a human being, and that human being was Jesus Christ. A first century Palestinian Jew born to a woman named Mary, who had what we might call a stepfather named Joseph, because Mary had Jesus as a virgin. He was uniquely inseminated in Mary by God Himself through the Holy Spirit. That's why Jesus is called the God-man. He is God and He is man, and He represents the way for us to reconnect with God. The way for us to get to God is through Christ. But for our purpose today, Jesus is the best representative of who you are supposed to be and who I am supposed to be. Now you say, no, wait a minute. This is kind of strange, Pastor, because if we're all like Jesus, then we're all just going to be alike, right? Not really. I was reading recently and reminded again of a quote, an illustration that was used by C.S. Lewis about a room full of pianos. Imagine a room full of pianos. Oh, this might have been Tozer, but I think it was Lewis, right? If that room full of pianos is all tuned to the same piano at the front of the room, they will all be different pianos, will they not? You could have a stand-up piano. You could have a baby grand. You could have a grand piano. You could have every kind. You could have a Kawasaki and a, you know, who knows what else. There is a brand of piano called a Kawasaki, I think. All right. You know, a Dusseldorf or whatever. Okay. Lige can give me the names of pianos. All of these different pianos, right? And they're going to have different sounds and they're going to have different purposes. One's for a concert. You could take a like this, keyboard that is up here and tune it to the same piano. All right, they're all tuned to that same piano. Each one of them has their own sound and their own purpose, but they're all tuned to that same piano. So if you know how to play the piano, you could go to any one of those and play it. Isn't that right? Okay, so this is us and Christ. If you want to know who you are, you need to know Christ. You need to find your identity in Jesus Christ. Jesus called himself the Son of Man over and over. Well, why would he call himself the Son of Man? Well, it was a title that represented the Messiah. The Jewish people were looking for Messiah, and this was Jesus' way of saying, I am indeed Messiah. But it speaks to us also because it means that he is the perfect representative of what it means to be a human being. So if you want to figure out what it means to be human, don't look for some hero in a comic book. Don't look for some hero in the movies. Don't look for some athletic hero. Don't even look to these wonderful figures that are in our lives that have loved us, parents and grandparents and so forth. If you want to look at what it really means to be human, you need to look at Jesus. Every single one of us, if we need to understand who we are, need to look at Jesus Christ. Now, when you give your life to Jesus, when you surrender yourself to him, something happens inside of you. It's not just an intellectual exercise. When you open yourself up, Jesus Christ sends a part of himself. He sends his spirit into you. That's just a manner of speech, but I'm just trying to get it across to you, okay? The Holy Spirit comes into you. We say Jesus in your heart. But the Holy Spirit comes in and he surrounds your spirit, kind of think of it that way, and he brings a new birth about. In fact, Jesus was talking to a very religious man one time, Nicodemus. And Nicodemus complimented Jesus and told him he was a rabbi and nobody could do the great things that he did. And Jesus didn't even talk to him about that. He didn't even say, well, thank you, Nicodemus. I appreciate that. I appreciate the compliment. No. You know what Jesus said? He said, unless you are born again, you will never see the kingdom of God. Okay. What? And then the guy, you know, was kind of confused and he said, well, how can I go back up into my mother and then be born all over again? Now, he was probably playing along. He didn't imagine that Jesus was really saying that, although who knows. And then Jesus said, unless you're born of water and of the Spirit, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Well, what does that mean? Well, born of water, some people have seen that as an allusion to baptism. Born of the Spirit is this spiritual birth that I'm referring to right now, where the Holy Spirit comes in and literally transforms you on the inside. But in all likelihood, when Jesus said you need to be born of water, he was talking about natural birth. Ladies, how many of you in this room, ladies, have had a baby? Raise your hand. Okay? What happens shortly before you have that baby? What breaks? Yeah, it's not literally water, is it, right? It's amniotic fluid. But the point is, the baby is surrounded by that amniotic fluid, metaphorically water. The natural birth is the birth through water, okay? The supernatural birth is the birth through the Spirit. When we're baptized, we're put under the water, and then we're raised up out of the water as a way of symbolizing the supernatural birth, that new birth. The scripture says, if any person is in Christ, that person is a new creation. Old things are passed away. Well, that's a euphemism that we use for death all the time, isn't it? When we want to be very, very kind and we want to remember someone fondly, we don't say they died. We usually say they passed away. Has anybody else used that phrase? Okay. Old things, the old life, the old you is passed away when you come to Jesus. And all things, it says, have become new. That's 2 Corinthians 5:17. If anyone is in Christ, they're a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. So we find our identity in Christ, but that's more than an intellectual exercise. That is a supernatural, spiritual transformation. However, you have to agree with it in your mind. You may not understand it all, but you have to receive it, and you have to walk in it. Now, there are a lot of people today who have a misunderstanding of who they are. I was reading recently that there was an organization of social workers that was talking to social workers about not not treating someone differently just because they believed they were a vampire. Not belittling someone or trying to dissuade them from believing that they are. How many of you know that there is no such thing outside of literature and movies as a vampire? You do know this, right?
Well, I don't know, Pastor. I've seen some mighty...
You haven't seen anything. Okay? This didn't even exist as a category prior to the 19th century when the literature was written about it. But this has come into the culture so powerfully that you have people who literally believe they are vampires. Just like there are people who believe they are Batman. There's only one Batman. And he's in a comic book. But he has a distant cousin sitting in the back here. Okay. People identify with something outside of themselves, and they see what that something or that someone is, and they start acting like that. And they may come to believe that that's indeed what they are. Here's the beauty of you and I being in Christ, is when we look at Jesus and we begin to act like Jesus, we're not pretending to be something that we aren't. We're acting like someone that we have become. Wow. Now, you can pretend to be religious, you can pretend to be a preacher, you can pretend to be a priest, you can pretend to be some sort of a holy figure, but when you get into the scripture and you see Jesus and you begin to say, I'm going to line my life up, I'm going to align my life with Jesus, you are actually, if you're listening, say I'm listening, you are actually acting like you. Say what? When he appears, that's Jesus, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. That's what it says in 1 John. Listen to it again. When he appears, Jesus has said he's going to come back. We who are in Christ will be like him, for we shall see him as he is. What happens is it's like you coming out of a shell. The shell peels away, and the only thing that is left is the you that is like Jesus, because that's all that's going to live on forever. All the rest of that is just going to die and go away. So when you and I realize that we are created on the inside, or perhaps I should say recreated on the inside to be like Jesus, when we have called on him to come into our lives, when we've surrendered ourselves to him, the Holy Spirit comes, he does this mysterious, miraculous work of regeneration, and he recreates us. That's who we really are. When we look at Jesus in the scripture, we're looking at ourselves. Listen to what it says in Ephesians chapter 4. This is Ephesians chapter 4. I'm going to start with verse 17. If you guys will put the passage up there, it starts in verse 19 up there. So I tell you this, the Apostle Paul writes, and insist on it in the Lord. That's Jesus. The Lord is Jesus. I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. Or the newer NIV says, and they are full of greed. Verse 20, that, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. Verse 22, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. What you do is you put on a new identity. All right? Have you ever heard the phrase, I don't hear it used much anymore. I used to hear adults say this when I was younger, that the clothes make the man. Have you ever heard that phrase before? Okay. Have you ever bought a new outfit, a new suit, whatever it is that you wear, dress or something, and put that on and stood in the mirror and you just felt new? You just felt better? You just, I don't know, you felt like you wanted to act differently. I feel different when I'm wearing shorts than I do when I'm wearing a suit. When I'm wearing a suit, I kind of want to straighten up and, you know, I want to be a little bit more formal. When I'm wearing shorts, I kind of want to be more informal. We dress in a way that communicates something to everyone around us, and it also communicates something to ourselves. So, in a very real sense, if you're going through, let's say you're going through a time of depression, okay? And many of us struggle with this at one point in time or another. And we don't feel like dressing up. And we don't feel like getting out of the house. Can I make a suggestion to you? Now, I'm just a preacher. And you can go to a counselor, though, and you might find that they might suggest the same thing. Can I make a suggestion? Get yourself out of bed anyway, even though you don't feel like it. Take a shower or a bath or whatever it is that you do. Get cleaned up, all right? Trim your beard or shave. Get cleaned up. Ladies, if you wear makeup, put makeup on, do your hair, and then dress up. Go somewhere. Do something. You might find that you begin to conform to this external. Well, what we're doing is we're trying to see ourselves differently. Now, what I'm not saying is fake it till you make it, a phrase from the drug community. What I'm trying to say is that you need to realize that who you are is not how you feel. Oh, wait a minute. Who you are is not how you feel. The devil is able to manipulate your thinking and manipulate your feelings as the result. All right? I may think a certain way one day and think another way the next day. I may feel a certain day one week and feel a different way a different week. In fact, some people that struggle with a disorder known as bipolar disorder may feel up and they may feel hyper and they may feel like they're on top of the world one day or one week or one month, and then they feel down and they feel like everything is wrong and everything is bad. You cannot conform to the way you feel. You need to make the way you feel conform to who you really are. And who you really are, listen, wait for it, is not just inside you. There is an image for who you are that is stored outside you. All right? Let's turn over to Colossians, and I didn't put this one up there, but this is Colossians chapter 3, and you've heard me quote this in this church on a number of occasions. I'm going to begin with verse 1 of Colossians 3. Since then you have been raised with Christ, so he's talking to believers, and he's saying, you need to think about this in your mind. You were buried with Christ to your old life. That's why we baptize people and we put them under the water when we baptize them. You were raised in Christ to walk in a newness of life. So just like one day you will be literally resurrected and have a new body, right now you have been spiritually raised from the dead. Now, he says, since you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts or set your minds on things where? Above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, for you died, set your mind on things above and not on earthly things. For you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Wow, that's just like what I quoted earlier. When he appears, we will like him, but we will be like him, for we'll see him as he is. Listen to this verse, verse 4, Colossians 4, 4. When Christ, who is your life, oh, basketball is my life. Oh, softball is my life. Oh, my kids are my life. No, Christ is your life. Yeah. Amen? Yeah. Your kids are worthy of your attention and your affection and your everything. Yeah. But Jesus is your life. They're not your life. Jesus is your life. And if Jesus is your life, they're going to turn out better. Amen? Amen? Because when they're your life and they look at you, they just see reflections of themselves. And they think, wow, I am all that, aren't I? I got my daddy wrapped around my little finger. He'll do whatever he wants. You know, I remember when Craig was trying to figure out whether he was going to have a daughter or a son, he's like, I hope it's not a daughter because I'm never going to be able to discipline her. Now, I've seen him with her, and he does know how to discipline her appropriately, and she's the sweetest little thing in the world. Oh, my goodness. She found out that I hung out with Nicholas that one day when Tashir needed a babysitter, and nobody could babysit him, so I was like, oh, okay, well, it's been a long time since I hung out with a five-year-old, but okay. Okay, I've never hung out with a five-year-old, but okay. So I'm like, what do I do with this kid? Well, you know, the whole upstairs up there is like kid stuff. So it's like, okay, well, I'll work on my computer and I'll let him like go do kid stuff, you know. And he did kid stuff or whatever. And I was like, okay, well, I guess I'll take him to the park. Parents, your job is exhausting. Golly. They're wonderful, but they're wow, okay. So now Jubilee says, I'm going to talk to my mommy because we need to hang out together. So I feel him all the way. I'm like, how do you discipline this little angel? I mean, how do you say no to that kid? You know, I just like the way I say no to Jubilee is, Rachel. So I understand, okay? But the point is, your children are not your life. Christ is your life. And your life is not even down here. It can't be spoiled or taken from you. Your life is hidden with Christ in God. So you look up and you look away and you look to Christ to discover your life. And when he appears, look at what it says again in verse 4. When Christ, who is your life, appears, you also will appear with him. Wow. Wow. So figure it out, friends. Your life is defined in Christ. Now, the last thing I'm going to say to you today as I conclude is that your life is refined in community. Your life is defined in Christ. That's who you really are. Once you give your life to Jesus, he transforms you from the inside out. He saves your life with him in glory. But your life is refined in community, okay? How many of you have ever heard of the Apostle Paul? Raise your hands, okay? Guy that wrote most of the New Testament under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. The guy that wrote all of the verses that I have read to you today. Well, if you want to read his testimony, it's contained three times in the book of Acts. The first time is in Acts chapter 9. He was stopped by Jesus himself in a bright light on the road to Damascus on the way to persecute Christians. He fell to the ground. He heard a voice saying, Paul, Paul, or at this point in time his name wasn't Paul, it was Saul. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you, Lord? He says, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. He recognized Jesus' voice as the voice of God, obeyed, went into the city of Damascus, and for 3 days was without food. He was fasting. Then he had a man named Ananias who came and laid his hands on him, and he had been blinded by the light. His eyes were opened, and he was baptized, and he took food, and he began immediately to preach the gospel. But do you know, it took years before Paul the apostle went out and became the apostle, the one that was sent out to start all of these churches and then write these scriptures that we're reading. Do you know how he was recognized? This is why I say you're defined in community. He was recognized by the church at Antioch. All right? Last scripture that I'll read. This is in Acts chapter 13. And this one is there, fellas. Acts chapter 13, verses 1 through 3. Will be the verses that I'm going to read as we conclude, because I want you to see how important church is. Church is not an institution. Church is God's called out people. We are God's community. Listen to this. This was the first Gentile church, that is the first non-Jewish church, and it was in a city called Antioch. Now, in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers: Barnabas, Simon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul, same Saul who was called on the road to Damascus. And this is many years later. This is 5, 6, who knows how many years later, okay? While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work which I have called them, to which I have called them." So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. Why did I read that verse? Because although Paul had been clearly called by God, his identity was clearly defined in Christ. His identity was refined and it was affirmed in community. And that community of faith at Antioch sent them out. So, you too are called. I started this off by saying to you, making the statement that you're here for a purpose, you're here for a reason. You too are called. First of all, you need to hear Christ's call to you to come to Him. Once you are in Christ, you need to begin to seek God for the calling that He has on your life, for the calling that He has in this season of your life. Because we are called to become like Jesus. But in each season of our life, we may be called to do things differently. Early on, I was called to youth. I did youth ministry for a long time. And I enjoyed doing youth ministry. And I didn't really think at that time that I was going to ever do anything else. That's just what I was called to do. So in the 90s and in the late 80s, I was a youth minister. But at the end of the 90s, it appeared to me, and it appeared to other people in the community where I was serving, that I was called to be a pastor and called to start a church. And so we started this church, and I have been pastoring. Well, even early on, this church was comprised really of a different age group and in many respects kind of a different type of person than it is now. Well, I was called to them then. I'm called to you now. Are you following? I'm just using me as an example. Not everybody's called to be a pastor of a church start a church, called to be a preacher. But you are called to something right now in this season of your life. And it may not be identical to what you were called to do at another time or another season of your life. But that is going to be refined and affirmed when you're in community. Now, that doesn't mean don't talk to the Lord about what you're called to do. It just means that that refinement of what that is going to come in community, because other people are going to see it in you. If I had this overwhelming impression that I was called to be a worship leader, you guys would really, really quickly tell me, no, Pastor. We think that you have that wrong. I hope we're not crushing your spirit. You need to do something else, right? No, I love to sing, though. I would love to sing. I would love to sing and play lead guitar. That's what I really want to do. I really want to sing and play lead guitar. I want to get up here and rock for the Lord. But nobody listens to album rock anymore except for me and some old guys, right? So this is what I'm called to do. This is what I'm called to do in this season. You're called to do something in your season of life as well. But start at the beginning. Who are you? You will discover that in Christ. And then let Him define you, and let this community, or the community that God calls you to, refine and affirm you. Let's pray together. Pray with me. Say, Jesus, You are the Son of God. I surrender my life to You. I open my heart. I invite You to come inside. Be my Savior. Be my Lord. In You, let me see who I am to be. I will follow You. In Your name I pray, Jesus. Amen.